How many people use Drupal here? Nobody. Oh, how many people know what Drupal is? Can you tell us? It's a content management framework which basically is quite similar to Joomla or something like that, which lets you primarily build websites of kinds. So we're not going to talk about Drupal here, what Drupal does really, because that's out of the scope. What we're going to talk about, and when I say, the top of my title says zero touch Drupal development, because I primarily, what I do is spend a lot of my time managing other people's Drupal code. And the use cases that I have to do this kind of work in is managing Drupal instances, several of them across a life cycle of a project, which primarily starts at QA and testing, goes on to a staging environment to get approvals from clients and partners, and before we move live. So, so of course, the purpose of such a workflow is to maintain a sane audit trail of change, reduce risk and liability, and be able to roll back changes easily. So you don't want to go live and go, we screwed up, let's go back. Sorry. Language, we'll try and be a little more polite. But a lot of this workflow, especially when it comes to Drupal and other similar content management framework, is done manually a lot of the time, because Drupal as a system likes to keep a lot of its configuration, a lot of the Drupal mechanics, whether it's content types, different data types, or your views, or your taxonomy, vocabularies, categories, all of that stuff in a database. And we all know getting what lives in a database into version control is not the simplest thing. So it's something that we've struggled with as Drupal developers for many, many years, and we have tried and worked through this over the years, and now we use something called Features, which is essentially a Drupal module which lets you export the mechanics of a Drupal website into code. So anything that lives in the database can be can now be exported into code as another Drupal module, which can then be pushed to code and pushed into version control. So that simplifies the first issue we have, which is now everything, pretty much everything in your Drupal environment can go into version control. Now, the next bit is, how do we deal with going from QA to stage to live? A lot of the time, it comes down to, this is how a lot of Drupal agencies who develop for clients I've worked with or I have seen do it. They primarily develop centrally, where everyone's SSH engine making changes to your Drupal configuration, your themes and modules, and then taking your code base dump and your MySQL or Postgres dump and putting it into a state site, and then taking it to live. The problem with this is there's a huge chance of human error. There is also the fact that there's fatigue on the developers, because they have to be involved in deployment at all times. As system administrators, our job is to take that fatigue away from developers and let them just focus on development. Because clearly that has advantages, like developers then commit often, release often, without having to worry about, I need to get SSH in there, get my code up there, test it there, move it somewhere else. So the idea is to automate this stuff. All the developer needs to do is, how many of us use Git here? Okay. So all we want to do is, we're pushing to a certain branch, and those changes go live onto the branch that is instance that associated with that branch. So the methodology we follow, where I work and a few other people I have worked with in the past, is we use Git. Everything's version controlled in Git. We use separate branches for separate stages of the life cycle of a project. So I usually what we do is we commit anything that's QA and testing stage is committed. All developers are committing to the master branch. And then we automate the process of how anything that's committed is detected and pushed to your testing or QA instance of your approval. When you're happy with your QA stage, you want to stage it. So this time what you do is you're just merging your changes, doing a git merge into a staging branch. And again, we pick up these changes, automatically detect these changes, and push it to the stage side. And the next process is, of course, going live, which is again merging your code from stage to live. Of course, it still gives the developers the flexibility to have their own feature branches, hotfix branches, as long as they merge it back into the master. Now, how do we do this, right? You'll have to be a bit patient with me. My laptop died last night. I'm using a machine I think was developed in like 1943 or something. So things might be a wee bit slow. So we just talked about the concept. We use version control for all code. We use features in Drupal. I'm not going to really talk much about features. It's quite self-explanatory. If you ever, none of us really develop in Drupal here, so I'm going to leave that out for now. If you do get into Drupal development, I think the first thing you should look at is features, so you can manage your code that lives in the database in version control. One of the things about automating the process of going from QA to stage to live is making sure that you are consistent across your whole environment. So if you've got a QA testing server and a staging server and a production server, just make sure you're always running the same operating system versions, same kind of software running across these instances of servers. Always use the same naming convention across projects for repositories and branches. Makes life easier in terms of many developers coming in and out if there is a naming standard. Always use the same workflow for each project.
Each environment has how many machines?
Sorry?
Each environment has how many machines?
Well, okay, so for the purposes of this example, we're dealing with, say, let's say three servers. One is your QA server, one is your staging server, one is your... But that can, of course, change. Eventually, you're pushing to a staging environment or a live environment, which can be one or multiple servers. That is, again, outside the scope of what we're doing today. So that's... For the purposes of this example, like I'm going to do a demo later, which I think is a fun demo. Where I'm just going to use the same server, which is a VPS I set up last evening for the purpose of this demo. We're going to just push to one server today, but we're going to push our QA stage and live environments to the same server. But it can go anywhere, basically. So as long as we follow the same naming convention, same kind of platform consistency across our environment, we should be fine if we want to automate these tasks. So how do we automate? What do we do here? The idea is we want to eliminate the need for a developer or a release manager, for example, to log into a remote staging server via SSH and run a git pull or a custom bash script to apply a change and change virtual host configurations, manually perform database modifications. We want all of this stuff. So what's the technology we use? Git, we spoke about Git. We spoke about different branches for different stages of a project's lifecycle. This is where things start to get interesting. How many of us are familiar with Jenkins here? So Jenkins is a continuous integration server. It's used a lot to run a lot of it does all kinds of things, but it's used by a lot of people to run test suites on applications and stuff. But one of the things that Jenkins is really good at is it's a reactive tool that can basically detect changes in a code base and then run any number of arbitrary tasks or commands connecting to local or remote servers over SSH or several other means of communication. fun part about Jenkins is that it's very good at determining success or failure when it's running a task. And it's got an amazing notifications API. So it can email you on an unsuccessful or unstable build. And because it's detecting changes from a Git repository, it can even email the culprit going, hey, you broke the build. Which is good because in this scenario, the developer is making one push to one branch. And in most cases, when you're doing that, you're still sitting at your desk watching your build. And when you get that notification, you know it's broken, you're in a good position to fix it. So how do we do this? So what does Jenkins do here? It primarily monitors a certain branch of a Git repository. I'll do a demo of this in a bit. It's going to watch your test branch. You commit, you push a change. Jenkins immediately gets to work. It detects your push and goes, cool, now I got to do something about this. And this is what we do.
How many of us know what Fabric is?
Any Ruby guys here? You know what Capistrano is? So Fabric is very similar to Capistrano. It's basically a Python API which can run a number of arbitrary tasks on local or remote servers over SSH. And it can do all kinds of stuff. You can it basically takes a fab file where you define your commands, takes a string to connect to a certain server and runs that fab file. And pretty similar to what Capistrano does. You could totally replace Fabric with a tool of your choice and use Fabric because I just understand Python better than Ruby. So what Jenkins now does is actually detects that change and runs some shell code. In this case, it is running a little script which is a Fabric command, looking at a fab file and going, hey, I detect a change. What I'm going to do now is take that change, push it to my test or stage or live server based on what repository what branch the commit's gone into, and executes that change. We use something called Aegir. Anybody heard of Aegir? It's a hosting automation backend to the front end and back end tool, which relies on a couple of different modules called Postmaster and Provision and Drush. Drush is primarily a command line tool to talk to Drupal instances. And what Fabric now does is actually sends a bunch of commands, which are Drush commands, to my Provision Aegir server, going, I detected a change, pull that, make a new build. You already have an existing site, make a new build, migrate that site to this build, and make the changes necessary to the Apache virtual host configuration, and your site is live, whether it's your test stage or live site, depends on the comment that's going. So, the idea is you still basically pushing to a Git repository, and you need the build process here is primarily it's not actually compiling anything. All it is doing, as you will see, so when I talk about a build in Drupal, what I primarily mean is what we also refer to as a platform, which is primarily your Drupal code base, the modules that you need to run your Drupal site, your templates, and all of that. Which are primarily, so if I make a change to a theme, a Drupal theme, so if I change one five lines of CSS in my template, it could be as simple as that. And what happens in this case now is, instead of obtaining that CSS file that exists on the server or uploading it, what we're going to do is we're just going to take the changes out of Git, create a new platform, and Drupal has a multi-site hosting configuration. So what happens is you can run one platform and you can run multiple sites within a platform. So what it's doing is creating a new platform. Your site's already running on one platform. It takes that site from there and moves it to your new platform where your changes are. So the things that change here are your site folder within a Drupal instance is primarily, you have your site name.tld folder in there. So for example, example.com lives in a platform folder called say XYZ. Now you have a new platform with new changes and that's called ABC. So what it's going to do is take that site's folder out of XYZ, put it to, after it's created your new ABC platform on the server and move it to ABC. Then there are a few things that need to happen. Your Apache configuration needs to be changed to point to the new platform. All of that is done by agent and provision automatically once it knows that I need to migrate. I just send a migrate command. This site needs to move to this new platform. So that's the same thing basically. So in your case, what you have is you will have three different stages of development, your QA test, QA stage and live, right? So if you're committing to a certain branch, you can still use Jenkins to detect that change and run a command to just send those changes to a particular branch. The various combinations possible. I think when you see the demo, you'll probably start to understand how these things can. I don't know. You can totally take.
Just one second.
Sorry?
I can manage just one second.
Okay. Yeah, but even if you're just managing one setup, you still have a process where you have to move from QA to stage to live. Yeah. So, and if you're doing that manually, there is, that means as a developer, you are getting involved in deployment, and that's the idea, eliminate debug. And the other thing, other advantage here is that, the other advantage here is that the whole way you do security now suddenly changes because you don't have to SSH into servers. Developers aren't SSHing into servers. So if there are five developers working on one code base, they don't need to have SSH access anymore. All they're doing is pushing to Git and pushing to a certain branch of Git and then we determine where those changes are going. Precautions, of course. So everyone has to take precautions while with any kind of automation. So if you create a new build, you need to make sure your previous one's backed up. With any kind of version control, we can always revert back changes, but it can get complicated, right? Especially when there's like database and stuff involved. So what we do in this case is when I create a new platform or a build, we make a backup. Again, this is done by Azure during the migrate process automatically. It makes a backup of the whole code base and the database into a separate folder before it creates a new platform and migrates your site. So, in case something goes wrong, you can always just fire up your last backup and go back to your platform instead of struggling with reverting changes within version control. And then you deal with it on the version control level where you fix things and push again. So going live, I think we spoke about how we're going live. So the advantages of automating this whole process of going from test to stage to live is that you suddenly see more frequent deployments happening because developers are dealing now with smaller change sets. They're not moving whole code bases and SQL files around from one place to another. All they are doing is committing, pushing, and your changes are there. Makes it a lot easier to test their changes before they know that they can go to the next thing. Of course, it gives you a much better audit trail where you can actually track every little change that's happened. You know who the culprit is if something goes wrong. And because of that, developers become more confident. You know you're working with smaller changes. Something goes wrong, it's easier to avoid. Also, it gives them more ownership over their own changes because everyone likes to see a little Git commit coming from them. You don't see that if you're like moving whole code bases around from one place to another. So people do start to take more ownership when they're working on little things and pushing often, committing often. Of course, there's less potential for data loss because you're working with a workflow where you're going test to stage to live, and you always know when you're ready to go to the next stage, and so you're not gonna suddenly push something to a live site there and break it.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said earlier, there's just a lot less fatigue on developing because they don't have to work with deployment tools on a server now, because that's being taken care of.
How often do you push changes
to
your
development problem? The way we work is, when you think you want to push to test,
you push.
If I'm sitting and working on my local instance for 3 hours and I think, okay, I've got a feature that I want to push now, I will push it there. And the idea is, you don't have release timelines of when you push to test. Now you can have release timelines on stage and live, of course, you always have release timelines. Well, it depends. It depends on project to project, right? You need to know that your test, you're happy with your test environment. Once you're happy with your test instance, you make a decision that we're ready to go to stage, you go to stage. And when we have approvals that we need on stage, or the changes we make, then we go live.
So, as part of
the
testing, you also have performance testing.
Yeah, so that's a separate set of performance needs. So there's performance testing at different levels, right? There's performance testing that done at individual levels, right? Primarily it's all handled by what type of code we expect to write. And also there's all kinds of tests that we run on applications. Now there are different tests that are done, especially with people who are based on whether it's a test server or the live server. So yeah, that's a part of the whole workflow where you're testing it all the time. So yeah, it's a performance optimal. I spoke about notifications. Now Jenkins, like I said, can send an email on a broken build or an unstable or an unsuccessful build, and it will look at your Git commit and also send you a notification if you are the individual who broke the build. Jenkins also, the notifications API is very flexible, so you can plug in all kinds of things. You can there's apps, iOS apps which can like talk to Jenkins and like do push notifications to your iOS app. You can plug in SMS gateways in there, so you can make people's phones beep, their email inboxes beep, or you can send their push notifications to their iOS and Android forms. So that's okay. What I'm going to do is okay. So the only reason I made these slides is just to kind of keep me on task. But what I will do is I will add a few things to this and put it up on the funnel, where there are some links that you guys can look at. That a lot of this work we do is a lot of this setup is actually based on a lot of work that this amazing French-Australian developer called Miguel Jacques, who I work with quite closely, has done. He's been kind of like working really hard over the last few years to automate a lot of Drupal deployment. And I'll put up links in these slides and put them up on the funnel to a couple of white papers that he's written. And he's actually written a lot of stuff where you can use similar setups with Drupal not being involved at all, where you just use a CI server, use Fabric, and Git branches to manage your whole workflow. Shall we do a little demo? I'm going to try and move my browser open. Okay, so that's what a typical Jenkins dashboard looks like. You install it on your server, you secure it, and then you're basically ready to go. Now, Jenkins has an amazing plugin API again. So one of the plugins we have enabled here is the Git plugin, but you can write all kinds of stuff. And it integrates not just with Git, but pretty much any SCM that you can think of, or whatever you prefer. This is how the Aegir front end looks like. Now, you might notice that I have a couple of sites here set up. This is the actual Aegir instance that is that Aegir is running on. It's basically maintained within Aegir. And when you upgrade Aegir, it just, again, takes that Aegir instance into a new platform. This is a test site that I set up for this demo. We'll look at that in a minute. So this Aegir does all kinds of things. Like, I can just go in here, go create content, just like I would on a Drupal site to create an article. I could just create a server or a site. So I could create a server and go, oh, I want a new MySQL server. That's the IP. That's the port I want to connect to. That's the root username and password or whatever username and password I want to connect to, and connect it up to another MySQL server or another Apache server. It does clustered setup, so you can have one Aegir master and have as many slaves as you want and deploy across web servers and database servers. It's pretty nifty actually. A platform, when I say I create a platform, it primarily means I'm just creating a Drupal platform, which is primarily a Drupal code base plus any install profiles or any custom stuff that you might have. So you can do all of this stuff from the web front end. You can create a new Drupal site based on what platforms you've already got in your Aegir instance from the web interface. But we haven't ever used the web interface. For a lot of setups where you want to manage a few Drupal sites and you want to be able to just quickly fire up Drupal sites across different versions of Drupal, it works really well. So you can have a platform, for example, running Drupal 6 and another platform running Drupal 7. Now, you want to create a new Drupal 7 site, you just go create site, use this platform, which is a Drupal 7 platform, and your Drupal site up in like the next minute. So what Aegir relies on is Provision, which then relies on Rush, which does all the work in the command line. There's a cron job that runs every minute, which does the dispatch. And if you actually scroll down here, I don't have it up here, but primarily what it does is it has a task queue, and you can tell it how many tasks it can execute on each cron run. And what we do is we run a cron run every minute and run about five tasks. So I can do things like, with Aegir, I can do things like if there is a site running on Drupal 6.22 and 6.24 releases tomorrow, I can just go into that platform and hit a migrate button and go migrate all sites in this platform to the new release 6.24, and it'll do that. So it'll hand it over to Provision, run the cron. When that's done, Aegir will tell you that it's done. So that's how the web front end works. It's very simple to configure and get up and running in terms of like getting a multi-site Drupal installation done. Now let's go back to Jenkins. You will see that you'll see that I have a little task here going deploy test.conv.com from master. You want to tell me what that might mean? So what it means is basically I am deploying my test site to you can call this anything, but basically what this task is doing is deploying from the master branch of my Git repository to test.onv.com, which is the Drupal website I want to be my desktop QA site. Let's look at this task. Slow VPS also, and it'll come up. Shouldn't take that long. How's the connectivity looking? SEO. Okay, there we go. Alright, so that's my project name, that's Jenkins task, which I've called whatever I want to call. If I scroll down here, you can see that I have chosen Git as my SCM. So that's the repository I want Jenkins to pull. That's my that's the repository. There's a bunch of advanced stuff that you can do. So you can actually do things like by default Jenkins, every time it pulls a repository, will can even like tag it and create a new tag. Yeah, we don't use any of that. So basically, all we do is pull SCM. And everyone knows what a cron job is here. So it's basically the same syntax. I'm just polling this repository every minute. Now this is where I actually do what I want to do. Is that visible? So I'm running a little script here called deployment message. That's test.u4.net is the server, my test server that we looked at where the Edge instance is running. It takes a couple of a few arguments, which are now, so what's happening here is deployment SH is primarily passing these arguments to a FAT file. I'll show you the code in a second. That's the site I want to send this build to if I make a change. So test.hompy.com is my test site. That's an install profile. A Drupal install profile is primarily a set of modules or themes or custom code that you want to use to install your site. Master, now that's not referring to my Git repo, that's actually referring to the fact that it's the Aweber master server that I want to talk to. Localhost, on master database is running off, MySQL is running on localhost, and there's a build file. Now that is a build file that Trush will use, using Trush make, to actually build my site. I can just open it. So it's basically just, it's quite simple here. It can be more complex, but primarily all I'm doing here is get Drupal core, downloading it from Drupal.org, getting the version 6.22 of Drupal core. And then I have an install profile which lives in a Git repository, which is going to pull. Now that's Miguel's Git repository. That's an install profile. It's a simple install profile which has another make file in it, which will then fetch a bunch of modules and install your site. And that's the build number. Now, so what happens here really is, let's watch this happen, right? Let's go back here. So I'm actually in the folder, that's my Git repository where I am right now. So let me do a couple of simple things. And this keyboard is terrible. So I have three different branches in my repo. I master live and state. What have I got here? I primarily got, this is my install profile that we referred to earlier. And that's the repository that we pointed Jenkins to. So we'll just try and make a little change. Let's just edit a CSS file. I'm going to use map because I don't even know if Vim works on this one. So let's change something. I can't see much. going to assume. Be back. I can't quite tell what this is, but I'm just going to assume that's going to be an integer. I mean, it doesn't matter. We can just do anything, right? So I just edited, made a little edit to a CSS file. So let's go. And in the master branch. Yeah, let's push. Now, let's go back to the Jenkins interface. So Jenkins is now polling changes to that repository every minute. So we should start to see that little task come up here. As soon as it detects that change, it starts to, it gets to work and it goes, now it's building. So we can actually look at the console output of this build. So this is as it's happening. So started by an SCM change, it detected that something's changed in the repository. It checks out your code and checks out the revision and then runs deployment sh, runs the command that we asked it to earlier, asked Jenkins to run. Here it's building the platform, it's getting a bunch of modules based on my build file, Drush make build files. Done. Imported the platform and then made a backup. Tells me where it's made a backup to. And it saved the aliases and imported the website and the platform into Azure. Now if we look at Azure, that just happened. And it created a new platform, it verified that. That just didn't happen. So let's just refresh this. It should show me that's yesterday's day. Say 26, yeah, it does. Okay, so it verified a new platform, that's today's date and time, and verified this on the command. So it's moved my Drupal site to a new platform that is created, verified, and so what we can do now is try and see how we go to stage from test. We're just trying to create a new Jenkins task to now watch our stage branch in that repository and try and merge what the change we just did in test and try and get that to create a new site. And I think, yeah, we'll do this and then I'll quickly show you the scripts which I use, the deployment.sh and the fat file, and that would be it. Then we can go all the way to launch. So I'll create a new job in Jenkins. Since there's not much we want to change, I'll just copy the previous job and we'll edit that. Hello? Yeah, that feels supposed to auto-complete. But no. Okay, I'm gonna do something else here. Thank you. Yeah, we started about 10 minutes late. I'll be done in 5 minutes. Okay, this is not quite working, but you guys get the drift. Basically, what we did with test, what we do in this case is create a new Jenkins job, and instead of master, we'll go test. And I would just do a git merge, or you can cherry pick a commit, but to keep it simple, I was just going to do a little merge and watch the same thing happen again, where Jenkins detects the change in SCM, creates a new build again, runs my scripts, creates a new build again, and that was the make file we saw earlier, which builds the actual platform. So these are the actual scripts that Jenkins was running. That's the deployment message. So what it's doing is we're telling it where the fab file we want to run is, passing it a bunch of these are the arguments that fab takes when you run fab. So we're going host side profile web server to discover the make file we want to point to, and the build number, and the date. And the date is what we're using to create the new platform. So every time there's a new platform created, it's basically a date and time, a timestamp. So this is the bit that's happening. So if the build number equals 1, which means if it's the first time a task is running, we have to tell the script that the site doesn't exist yet, you have to actually create it. So these are the actual fabric tasks I'm running. I'll show you where these are defined in a second. So it's building the platform, it's saving the alias for the platform, which is what we have to do in AVL after we create a platform or a site, and then it installs the site. If not, we know that the site already exists, so it builds the platform and migrates the site, saves the alias, and then imports the site into Eager, which is what we saw in the Eager front end. Now that's the actual fab file, and this is where I'm defining those tasks. So what am I doing here? That's my build platform task, install site, migrate site, save alias. So this is a bunch of trust, make and trust commands. So it's making the platform, taking the arguments from what we came with in the deployment, and basically builds a platform, installs the site. Those are the fabric tasks we just defined in the fab file, and we get deployment sh to run these tasks, and that's pretty much what we do. So as you can see, it's like you can completely take Drupal out of this equation and still use a CI server and a bunch of fabric tasks to pretty much do anything you want. So sorry the demo didn't go very well, and we lost power and all that stuff, but yeah, that's pretty much it. Thank you very much. Any questions? Sorry?
So when you automatically merge your feature branches into
How often do we get?
Merge branches, I mean, it should be happening.
Well, that's something you have to be even at the version level. That's basically what you might need for. Right? So, we all do, but you then have to be
something. Okay, I have a popular way of developing is you commit everything into one thing, and just before you release, you branch out everything.
Yeah, so what we do is, so we always commit to master, and then we always then merge in. Anything that's being staged is always staged out of master, and anything that's going live is always coming from stage. So that's a workflow we quite live. We will never go from master to live or master. Now, it's quite common for developers to have little hotfix and feature branches. You can't not have those if you're working on individual. So there are times you can't commit straight to master, but eventually, every developer is always committing to master. We're not committing to stage or live in our process at all. We're always just taking master, and that goes to stage and that goes to live. Yeah, so we are always committing to one branch. Okay, thank you very much. I'll put up some further reading on the slides, and